Welcome back, everybody, to It Just Means More Softball, a part of the Softball America Podcast Network. We're the pod that covers the SEC, of course. Gray Robertson, my partner Tom Canterbury on the other side of the screen. Hello, Tom. How are you?
Good, Gray. How's it going?
Oh, you know, it's good. There's a national championship tonight, apparently. Yeah. It's Masters Week.
It is.
And a lot of softball.
It's the best time in sports. You're right in the middle of softball season. The Final Fours, both the men's and the women's, have been off the charts. Alabama in the Final Four, so that was great for us. The Masters, WrestleMania, it's all happening.
Shout out, by the way, the ratings have dropped for South Carolina, Iowa in the national championship. Huge numbers, so kudos to everybody at ESPN and on the women's basketball side for doing that. And, you know, let's get $18 million for Women's College World Series.
I think it can be done.
Why not?
Yeah.
Why not? Let's get 18 million subscribers to the Softball America YouTube page.
I'm really down for that if we want to make that happen.
That would be helpful. So give us a like, subscribe on the Softball America YouTube page. The chat is open tonight, so please pop in if you've got any questions about the Southeastern Conference. We're going to dive into each team, each series. We're going to look at what's to come this week. I'm labeling it Trap Weekend.
Look out.
Yeah. Be wary, everyone. But we're switching up the order tonight because we've got a really, really, really exciting special guest joining us. It's time, Tom, to get to the Big Bopper. And our guest tonight from the Arkansas Razorbacks, the transfer from Southern Miss, who this year with the Hogs is top 10 in innings pitched and strikeouts and is on a hot streak right now, Morgan Leinstock. Hello, Morgan. Welcome to the show. How are you?
Thank you for having me.
We are so excited to chat with you. We've got a lot to get to, and you're such an interesting and cool person. And I mean, we have so many questions, but I have to start with the transfer journey for you coming from Southern Miss to Arkansas. What was it about Coach Dyfel? What was it about Fayetteville that stuck out to you and told you that was where you wanted to be?
So first, I wanted to transfer to a school that had ultrasound tech, which is what I want to be when I grow up. But then I realized a lot of schools don't have it, and all these colleges were contacting me, and I just couldn't turn down any good opportunities. So what stood out to me about Arkansas was Coach Dyfel and all the assistant coaches and how they FaceTimed me, and they were the only people that did, and just seeing her big smile. And I committed before I even took my visit. So, but I wasn't signed yet. So I took my visit, and I just knew as soon as I stepped my foot on campus, and yeah.
How much do you feel that you have grown as a pitcher since you've arrived in Fayetteville?
I've grown a lot. Working with Coach Dyfel, she's the best. Like, she knows what she's doing, and she does really good pitch calling for me, and she can fix whatever I need to work on, and she's been doing a really good job.
Like I said, you're on a hot streak right now. You got two victories this past weekend against a really good Missouri team. The weekend before, you got two wins against Georgia, who might have the best offense in this conference. You've been pitching lights out. What has made you so effective these last few weeks, especially considering Robin Heron has had to miss some time, so you've had to step up even more so?
Yeah. We prep before the weekend to see where their bat angle is and how they hit. And I just tell myself to keep the ball low so I can feed my defense. I trust my defense, and they trust me and what I'm doing. And whenever I have to face them again, I watch film on myself on that game, like ESPN on demand. I watch myself and see what I can do better, and that's how I beat them the second time.
How nice is it to have such a powerful offense behind you as well, so you don't have to be just absolutely perfect in the circle? You make a mistake, it's okay, the offense has your back.
Yeah, we have really great transfers in the lineup, and even everyone is a really good hitter on the team. Everyone, even if we have pinch hitters, they will step up and do their job. So it's just really great having all these amazing hitters and doing their job.
Morgan Leinstock is our guest here on It Just Means More Softball, the pitcher from Arkansas. And Morgan, your life story is incredible, and I want to dig into that now if I can. A lot of this information I found out today, but you were born deaf. You play with a cochlear implant device. And knowing that now and looking back on your journey, it's incredible to see where you are right now, leading a team in the SEC and ERA and innings pitched. How would you describe what that journey has been like, and who are some of the people who have helped you along the way?
First, my parents, they're a huge, like, they helped a lot in this journey. I've gone through a lot. So when I was first born, I did not pass the newborn screening test twice. And then I did this test, it's called ABR or something like that. So it detects brain cell activity with sounds, and I passed that apparently. And so then they were just like, oh, you know. And then I grew up and I was 2.5, and then my parents were like, there's something wrong, you know. They had to figure out what it was, and they found out, diagnosed me with hearing loss. It was because the cochlea, which is the snail in your ear, is not formed correctly. So that's why I am deaf. And growing up in school and having all these people doubting me, saying that I'm not gonna make it and stuff. And my parents just advocated for me, getting my note taker in class, making sure getting what I need. And that helped me be able to do that for myself in college, because I don't have my parents with me in college. So I have to be able to do that for myself. So I just kind of learned what they did when I was younger. So
how much inspiration do you think that you can provide other athletes or other college students that are going through similar circumstances?
I would just say you're not different from anybody else unless you put the hard work in and be yourself. Yeah, that's pretty much it. You just got to be yourself, and you're not any different.
What was it about softball that stuck out to you as you were growing up and as you were learning how to live life as someone who was deaf? What was it about softball that made you want to play it?
So growing up, I played basketball, softball, soccer, okay, and then I moved to Arizona, and I just stuck with basketball and softball. I started travel softball when I moved to Arizona, and there was just these college coaches that came and watched me play, and I was so excited that they came and watched me play. But I was actually a utility player before I even started pitching in Arizona. And so I just liked having the ball so much, and I didn't have to worry about so much. You know, being a first baseman, you have to make sure you hear the catcher say cut, or, you know, like, let it go. And it was just a lot. Being a pitcher, you don't have to really deal with all that. I can just focus on the catcher and just pitch.
How much support do you get from your teammates in that type of way?
I get a lot of support. If I don't hear anything, they always tap my shoulder and be like, someone's trying to talk to you, or, you know, they help me in every way. So
what about that pitcher catcher relationship? You talk about how when you're in the circle, you know, it's you and the catcher oftentimes, but in the minutia moments, in those meetings in the circle, when it's truly you and Kennedy Miller, or Cameron Sender, whoever's behind the plate, how have those communication moments gone, and how has that chemistry grown, I guess, as the year has gone on?
So in the fall, we just kind of had some meetings, and You know, we talked about how, you know, it's with all the pitchers, not just me, how, like, to work with everybody and how everybody wants it, like, in certain ways. So me and Kennedy kind of talked about how, you know, because I'm visual and she'll do something visual to help me. So let's just say a runner is going to stay at third and I field a grounder. She's going to point at first to tell me to throw it to first instead of saying, go one, go one. So it's more hand stuff. And she's been doing a really good job doing that.
In these last few weeks, as you guys have really started to play extremely well, has there been a light bulb or light switch moment, or is it just kind of been something that's been continuing to grow as the season's gone on?
It's a growing process. It's for everybody on the team. We kind of started off kind of good, and then there were some games where we lost, but we didn't let that affect us, and we just kind of responded from those games that we lost, and we've been doing a really good job on doing that.
It's fantastic. Well, hey, Tom, I think, should we play a game?
I like it.
Okay, Morgan Leinstock. Morgan Leinstock is our guest here from Arkansas. Morgan, we're going to play a little game so that the people of the world can get to know you even a little bit better. We'll drop the intro video and then ask you a few questions because it's time to play some Pepper.
Here we go.
All right, Morgan, your favorite place to eat in Fayetteville?
I would say I haven't really been out a lot here, but I would say JJ's Bar and Grill.
Okay. All right.
I have not been there before.
What is your favorite movie to watch over and over again?
Love and Basketball.
Great. Yes. I love that. Okay. Awesome answer. So when you were at Southern Miss, heck, I mean, you've been on my boards multiple times. You've played in SEC stadiums and now getting to do it again with Arkansas. So what would you say is your favorite opposing SEC stadium to play in?
Georgia. Because their environment, like it was like everyone's like on you, but just hearing them, it was so cool to be in. Yeah.
I love that.
And probably enjoyed getting the win in that series too. What is your favorite comfort TV show to watch?
Grey's Anatomy.
That's like the third time someone has said that.
It's a perennial favorite.
So you're from Scottsdale, Arizona. What is one thing that the world should know about your hometown?
It's a really great place to do anything, like activities wise. You can go hiking, you can go tanning. There's just a lot of pools and it's really amazing there.
A lot of pools. I like that.
A lot of golf around there as well.
That's true. A Final Four.
Yeah.
That's right.
Who's the goofiest teammate on your team?
I would say Kylie Halverson because she's just crazy a lot of times. Like, she's just so crazy.
Is there a story that you can share that is air eligible about Kylie Halverson?
There's a lot. I don't really have one, but she's just, I don't know, she makes me laugh all the time. And I don't know. She's comfortable being around.
I love it. All right, last one. Favorite thing about Arkansas?
The fan base. I love playing in front of the fans. I love their support and they're so loyal.
That's awesome. Morgan Leinstock from Arkansas joining us here on It Just Means More Softball. Morgan, you're incredible. You're an inspiration and it was honestly an honor for us to have you on the show tonight. Thank you for telling your story to us tonight and best of luck the rest of the year.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Morgan Leinstock from Arkansas, our Big Bopper tonight. And you know what? She shut down the Big Boppers at Missouri and Georgia the last 2 weeks.
Really, really impressive. Like you said, especially considering They were down a pitcher in that pitching staff, and for her to step up was really good. Really well
Absolutely.
Done.
Absolutely. So thank you to Morgan for hopping on with us. Thank you to Grace for helping to set it up from Arkansas. And man, yeah, I love that. I love that. That was incredible. Thank you to our Big Bopper for hopping on tonight. Tom, I think it's time that we look back at the week. Shall we get to the quick hits?
Let's do it.
Tom, we begin with an SEC standings update. The Tennessee Lady Vols currently sit up at the top of the Southeastern Conference at 10-2 in the SEC. Right now, Florida and LSU is underway, and Raylan Chafin has walked two straight batters. Florida has a two on, nobody out in the bottom of the first, and the Gators currently sit in second place. Texas A&M in third at 10-5, LSU at 9-4 in fourth right now, Georgia in fifth, Arkansas in sixth at 7-5, both teams at 7-5, Mississippi State at 8-7 in seventh place, Alabama at 6-6 in eighth, Missouri 5-7 of a league in ninth, South Carolina, Kentucky, Auburn, and Ole Miss, the bottom four right now, and I'm realizing now how many dadgum teams are in this conference, and I just listed them, and we're adding two more next year. But
yes,
outside of, you know, the top two spots, there's not a lot of space between three Texas A&M, and I'll even go down to 10 South Carolina. There's not a ton of room.
Yeah, we haven't seen a whole lot of separation from the middle. You know, Tennessee, Florida have kind of separated themselves, with Tennessee getting the series victory over Georgia this past weekend, as the teams right now about halfway through the conference slate as the ones fighting for the championship. But 3 through 8 is pretty much up for grabs right now. With just a win here or win there, depending on who it's against, is going to get you set up.
Absolutely. And I mean, you know, Florida, LSU, a lot of stakes here, but we'll talk about, what this weekend means for what these standings could look like. But again, I mean, you know, you sweep a series like Alabama did this past weekend, and you instantly gain a game or two because of all the results elsewhere.
Yeah, I know. I made the point during the broadcast on Sunday for Alabama that the difference between being 6-6 and being 5-7, and that how important that game three was. And that's how it's going to come down for a lot of teams, that, you know, the differences in just one game, the swing is going to be the difference between maybe being third or fourth in the league and being eighth or ninth. Everything is so close together.
All right. So let's dive into the actual series themselves. Tennessee takes 2 of 3 over Georgia. Score-wise, seemed like a really even series. Tennessee wins 5-1. Georgia wins game 2, 3-2. Tennessee wins game 3, 3-1. I was texting Amanda Scarborough. She called game 2, and I said, I don't understand how there's a rubber match tomorrow. It feels like Tennessee's been the better team for 80% of this series. One mistake by Peyton Gottschall, Georgia took advantage. Tennessee's offense did not do enough in the latter stages of that game to set up a sweep. Karen Weekly started Charlie Orsini in game 2. So a lot about that was interesting. And then the Lady Vols got a late home run from Sophia Nugent, a 3-run shot in a game 3 where it looked like Georgia might win this series. So, I mean, Tennessee's got to feel good, but at the same time, like, they might have missed an opportunity a little bit to get a sweep over the Dogs.
Yeah, I think there's an element of that, but I think there's also more so if you're Tennessee, you got to think, we probably didn't play our best, and we just took 2 out of 3 from the team that most people thought we were going to be fighting with to win the championship of the conference. So I think if you're Tennessee, you feel pretty good about all the happenings. And if you're Georgia, really the last 2 weeks, the first time that we've seen any cracks in the Georgia armor, and to where they're getting people on base, but not getting them in. They're not coming through in those big situations like they were earlier on in the conference slate.
Yeah. And for Tennessee to do it all without Keke Malloy, a sudden announcement, I think it was maybe an hour before the game started, Repotke had it first. And look, I, I immediately saw that and thought, oh, okay, Georgia's got this. Like, yeah. Kiki being out is significant. But Tennessee, again, not only won the series, but looked like the better team without a player of the year type player at the top of the order.
But that's why Tennessee is so good. It's not just the Kiki Malloy show. Right. You know, they have McKenna Gibson. They have Riley West. They have Laura Mueller. They have, you know, the pitching staff, Gottschall and Pickens. They are a complete team. And to be able to beat a team the caliber of Georgia without a conference or national player of the year type player like Kiki Malloy said a whole lot.
Yeah. Georgia team batting average actually is still better than Tennessee, which is interesting. 307. Lady Vols are at 302. Kearney is hitting 380 right now. You will notice that Mosley is off the page here because the batting average is down to a 330-ish, which is good for most people in the world. But for Sarah Mosley, kind of a coldish weekend for her that brought down the numbers just a bit. And the pitching staff has been solid, you know, Backus, Walters, Kerpix, and we talked to Amanda Scarborough for the Out of the Box podcast as well. It just seems like they're not all hot at the same time. Walters is pitching really well right now, and that's coinciding with Backus kind of slacking just a little bit, you know, giving up home runs and struggling with her location. If they can all get on the same page, then I think you've got a Georgia team that's right back up to where we think they can be.
Yeah, that's what we saw like a few weeks ago when we were there with Alabama in Athens taking on Georgia, just in a complete team in both the starting lineup and the pitching staff. And we're seeing, like you said, just not everybody clicking at the right times or all at the same time. And they're still really good. So some people are clicking, but if they can get everybody at the same time, that's what they're going to have to be able to beat a team the caliber of Tennessee or others are going to face moving forward.
So the chat is open and I'm seeing a couple things pop up. First off, Tom, will you tell me what this means? Andrew Petty, Tom and Gray are the new version of The Rock and Undertaker.
I don't know. I'm not going to choke slam you that I'm aware of.
I hope not.
Last night in the main event of WrestleMania, Undertaker with the surprise appearance taking out.
Oh, was that the bell guy?
Gong, yes.
Okay, well, gongs are just fancy bells.
I've never heard the Undertaker described as the bell guy, but yes, I guess so.
Back to softball.
Only the greatest of all time, but okay.
Haley's question, do you think teams are starting to figure Pickens out at least a little bit in game two? I think that's like a pretty natural thing. You know, the more you see a pitcher, the more cracks you're going to get. But like we were just talking about, what makes Tennessee so effective is if there is a sign of trouble, Gottschall can just come straight in. And I wouldn't be shocked if we see going forward, especially against the, I don't know where that came from, against a really good offense, the caliber of Georgia's. I'm not sure however many others are on the schedule. I'm not looking at it right now, but I wouldn't be shocked if it's a Gottschall Pickens 1-2, however you want to do it. And then 3, just an even split where, you know, 4 innings of Gottschall, 3 innings of Pickens or vice versa.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, outside of it was Gottschall that got touched up by Fullerton, right?
Correct.
Okay. I mean, outside of that game, there's been just a couple of hiccups because you're going to have those because nobody's perfect. I think Pickens somewhat surprisingly, just because almost everybody has a little bit of a dip in their sophomore season. It seemed as though Pickens kind of got that out of the way last year. You know, she had a little dip during her freshman year, and now I think she's as good as anybody right now.
Softball America has commented, ha ha ha, the bell guy. Hello to either Brady or Tara.
Yeah.
Or Sierra. I don't know. I don't know who that is, but one of you will be texting later. All right. So tonight is the rubber match of LSU Florida, and the Gators on an RBI walk have taken the lead in the bottom of the first.
Always crowd pleasing RBI walks. People like them.
Just real quick, here's how this first inning has gone for the Florida offense. Full count walk, line out to short, fly out to center field, 0-2 hit by pitch. And then a 3-1 RBI walk. And just now a 3-2 fly out to right. So that's a long bottom of the first.
Hmm.
But yeah. we'll keep an eye on that. The reason it's a rubber match is because Florida won game one, got a absolutely clutch home run in the sixth inning from Reagan Walsh after LSU went into that frame leading 1-0. And then game two, it was interesting actually hearing Tim Walton talk about it when we were recording his podcast earlier today. Florida, an out away, a strike away from going for the sweep tonight, but LSU finds a way, gets a run in the seventh, gets a run in the eighth. Coach Walton said, you know, obviously he wanted to win, but it was just a darn good softball game between two good teams. And it's been as even, Tom, as I think we expected it would be between these squads.
Yeah, I've been very, very impressed by both these teams in this series. Florida, a team that, even at, you know, at the beginning of the season, we were a little bit worried because of the youth. But that being said, we knew they had a lot of really good pieces, and they've really come together really well, starting in the circle. And then what we've seen, Otis and Erickson, what they've been able to do in this lineup. And really, they've come through in these type of series where maybe Florida in the last, you know, half year or so hasn't had as many opportunities to do so.
Yeah, and this LSU offense has been pretty good too. So I would be fairly surprised they're in the second inning now if the final score of tonight's game is 1-0 Florida. Both offenses are good. Rothrock, I'll tell you what, I'm going to give Coach Walton and Coach Dobbins, the new pitching coach, a lot of credit, because a big reason why Florida was a little lower on my preseason poll was I wasn't sure if this whole freshman have these two people throw basically every major inning thing would work, and it's working. Keegan Rothrock and Ava Brown have been a really good 1-2 punch, and it's been hard for teams to figure out both of them. They might get one of them on a weekend, but it's hard to get both.
Yeah, and real, I was looking at the SAT broadcast real quick because with all the walks in the first inning, I was looking to see if a certain umpire is behind home plate. It is a certain umpire, but it's not the one that we're thinking of. It's not this. It's one that has had a small zone in the past. We've dealt with at times, not the one we just did though.
Oh, and we have a friend on the crew too. I'm not going to drop names. No dropping names. So Haley has commented, did you see the shirts LSU wore for warmups yesterday? Yes. Great video that LSU tweeted out because it was alumni day at Florida and Betterina, notably a Florida alum. So they were wearing Betterina Florida shirts.
How about that? And she was certainly enjoying it too.
Oh my gosh, so good.
I wonder if she's found out who came up with those shirts. She was on a mission to try to figure it out.
You know what? We can ask our friend of the pod, Taylor Pleasance.
Yeah, we'll see. See if anyone wants to get the inside scoop on that.
Who wants to join us from the dugout right now? Might as well.
Yeah.
All right. We talked to Morgan Leinstock earlier, and by the way, if you're just joining us, and sometimes the interviews will flip if our subject or guest is here before the usual time we pop up. If you didn't see it, I could not recommend more going back and listening to our conversation with Morgan Leinstock. Her story is incredible, and I would hope that everyone gets to hear what she has to say. And a reason why we invited her, Tom, her team wins the series against Missouri. Win the bookend games, get run ruled in game two, but I was impressed by the response. And Leinstock, now a 1.79 ERA on the year, a 10-2 record. She leads the team with 98 innings. I have been very impressed with how not only she has thrown, but as we talked about with Morgan, how she's kind of stepped up with the injury to Robin Heron that's taken away a few innings. You know, the stage has been bigger for Leinstock, and she's pitched her best in those situations.
Yeah, I don't know if any of us had Morgan Leinstock moving up to being the ace of the Arkansas Razorback pitching staff on the bingo card before the season started. But yeah, when Heron went down, she stepped in and is pitching extremely well. The only issue with Arkansas, you know, they have these anomaly type games like game two against Missouri was. You know, that being said, Missouri is a good team, and I would have been surprised had Arkansas swept the series. But I was a little surprised that Missouri was able to get the run rule there in game two, as well as Arkansas was playing these last 2 weeks.
Yeah, and the Arkansas offense continues to deal. Bree Ellis hitting like crazy. Kenny Miller's average dropped from like 426 to a measly 382. I mean, killing it right now.
Yeah.
Reagan Johnson's on base all the time. Nia Carter had a home run. So they're getting it from everywhere, which is why that offense right now is so dangerous, even though the team batting average is below 300.
Yeah. And I think some of that's just kind of reflective of, you know, the struggles to start off with, but they seem to be stepping back up right now. And unfortunately for the rest of the league, about the best possible time if you're Arkansas.
Do you have concerns about Missouri's 283 team batting average, despite the fact that Laird is hitting 375 and Honnold is hitting 371? I know we've beaten this dead horse many, many times, but that is a big, big drop for the rest of the team compared to those top two.
I have a little bit of concerns. I have been kind of slow to jump on the Missouri bandwagon as a whole, despite some of their big early season victories. And some of that is just because of the consistency from top to bottom. That's a little bit lacking in this lineup. But as we saw there in game two, a very capable team that can rise up and put the hammer down at any time.
So Callan Dean, it could be Kalen, and I apologize. I'm realizing there's a football coach who lives around here whose name is somewhat spelt close like this. But
yes.
Callan Dean says, I think Arkansas might be a new Auburn. Always predict 2-1 with them winning both Leinstock games. So like the inverse Auburn.
Right, yes. Yeah. All right. Possibly. Yeah.
We'll talk about the Tigers in just a bit. Let's go to Davis Diamond, where Texas A&M takes 2 of 3 over Kentucky. Man, look, can the Wildcats have a normal series?
No, they can't. That's not how they play. That's not who they are.
Whoever negotiated that deal, I mean, the clauses in there are absurd.
What a contract.
So Kentucky is winning game 1-4-0. A&M comes back, walks it off, wins 5-4. Game 2 is off the rails.
just ludicrous.
I mean, we're on the air, and we start our broadcast, I believe it's 10-3 A&M, in like the third inning. It's
yeah, right.
Normal things. And Kentucky comes back, keeps chipping away. Riley Smith is up, drives in 2 with a base hit, and then gets mowed down at second. Aaron Coffle would have been on deck, but alas, and A&M wins 10-9. And then game 3, Stephanie Schoonover throws a 2-hit shutout, and Kentucky wins 1-0.
Of course she does, yes. Yeah. They're a reason why they're the original Enigma, and they're right back into that slot this season. I still haven't actually seen the entire play. It's been described to me what happened, but
man, no one wants to post it.
No one, even A&M didn't post it, which was weird. But like, gosh, taking the bat out of Aaron Coffle's hands with the chance to take the lead at the end of that game, just what a rough situation for Kentucky there against Riley Smith, who's obviously had a lot of late game heroics. We saw it last weekend, unfortunately.
And 3 years ago.
For us. Yeah, right, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, look, Kentucky is very much in a, as Stephanie Schoonover goes, so will the game, because right now the other pitchers on the staff just aren't trustworthy, and the offense seems to be getting a little bit more well-rounded, a little more help for Coffle. Riley Smith still leads the team in batting average. A&M is a team that we will see in Tuscaloosa this weekend. I mean, Emily Kennedy continues to lead the team the conference in innings pitched. And the offense has a lot of big boppers, but there are also games where they can go quiet. I mean, even Alabama wasn't shut out by Stephanie Schoonover, and it was interesting to track that game and rewatch that game and see how she was able to bamboozle the A&M hitters so much.
Yeah, it's going to be a very interesting series this coming up weekend between Alabama and Texas A&M, because both those teams have in some ways very similar makeups and flaws. But at the same time, when it all hits on all cylinders, they can both really be really good. So we'll see what happens when they play each other. But, you know, they were able to play Kentucky's game well enough to get the series victory. And, you know, that says a lot about them, that they're able, when things kind of go off the rails, they were able to hold on and get those wins.
All right, let's talk about Alabama since they are playing A&M this weekend, and they swept Ole Miss, the only sweep in the conference.
Yes, of course.
I mean, sure. We've had like five other times. So there was only one this weekend. Alabama did what they needed to do. And, you know, we'll talk more about the Alabama perspective on the Out of the Box podcast. We can say a word or two here. I thought for Ole Miss, it was so interesting covering this game on Friday and Sunday on SEC Network Plus and talking to Coach Traxel as deeply as Kaylee Towne I did. I hated that we had to beat on it so much during the show, but the situational hitting for Ole Miss was such a story. I mean, it felt like every inning, not only did they have people on base, they had people in scoring position. And a few times they had people in scoring position with Jayla Lassiter up, with Lexi Brady up, with Ansley Furbush up. They would, kind of similar to what Alabama did a few times prior, they would set it up and have the right people in the right positions and just not be able to get the hit. And part of that, of course, is a credit to the situational pitching for Alabama. But also at the same time, if you're Ole Miss, you got to find whatever was working when you were able to get those hits in Baton Rouge, because since then it's been really hard to score runs and come through in those big moments.
One of the most telling stats, in addition to the situational hitting stats, was that Alabama allowed only two runs all weekend, one earned, but only got four 1-2-3 innings. Ole Miss had people on base every inning. They were applying pressure every inning, but just could not get that hit at the right time, which unfortunately, you know, covering Alabama, we kind of deal with that some too for the Crimson Tide, but they were in a position to where I can see how they beat LSU, because they have people on base. If you just get that one hit, they're right there. But then you have somebody as good of a hitter as, say, Paige Smith is, and she literally fouled out to the catcher four times on the weekend, 3-1 game, and had two other foul outs during the game. So those are those non-productive outs that Alabama was able to force Ole Miss into and Ole Miss put themselves into.
Yeah. And, you know, it kind of goes back to some of the things that we've talked about from the Alabama perspective. And we talked about this on the radio side. The margins in this conference are so small, but if you miss your chances, you're going to lose. And Ole Miss right now is missing a lot of chances in these games. On our call this week, Coach Traxel brought up the point that, you know, even in the losing streak going into this series, there were a few games where they were either trailing by a run or tied in the sixth or seventh inning, and they couldn't find a way to get the hit at the very end when they needed it the most. And I say all that thinking, I think Ole Miss has the capability to be a pretty solid team and be a pesky NCAA tournament team, but they've got to figure out how to come through in those moments. And unfortunately, it's really the one thing in this wonderful sport that you cannot truly practice. You cannot recreate that in practice. It's just something that you have to mentally prepare yourself for and then do.
Yeah. And we talked about, ironically, with LSU, even though Ole Miss did it against LSU, but we talked about LSU, you know, when they have the lead or tied or just down one going in the seventh inning, more often than not, they're going to find a way to get that win. You know, we certainly talk about it with Oklahoma, the Know This SC podcast, but when we talk about Oklahoma on the other podcasts, that if it's close, Oklahoma's going to find a way to win. But there's also the antithesis of that, and that's kind of what Ole Miss is doing right now.
Haley asks, how worried are you about the Ole Miss overall record? Worried.
Yes.
I brought it up on the TV broadcast. Me too. And that's, I think that they have tournament team capability, but they're not going to make it if they're not above 500. That's the rule.
Yeah, they have a resume that says they should be in the NCAA tournament, but they also have lost either 9 out of their last 10 or 10 out of their last 11 overall, and are only now, I think, 3 games above 500, with half of the SEC schedule left. So yeah. I'm quite worried they're not going to be over 500. They're not going to be eligible.
Yeah, their bye week is coming up this weekend. They've got, I think, 5 games against solid, if not super scary, mid-major opponents, it's very, very important that they win all five of those games.
Right. Yeah, I think they're at La Tech in the midweek, and then they host Western Kentucky this weekend.
And then Southern Miss right after.
Yeah, like that. Those need to be six wins if they want to solidify that they're going to make it. But, you know, last week during the midweek, they split a doubleheader with UT Martin. So yeah. It's hard to say they're definitely going to be able to do that.
Anything quickly that you want to say about Alabama? Again, everyone check out of the box, but, you know, we'll give a brief synopsis. Yes.
Alabama did what they had to do. You know, the difference between, you know, even winning that third game and completing the sweep, the difference between being 6-6 in this league and being 5-7 at this point is just monstrous. And I think if you're Alabama, you have, you've got the positive momentum. You were able for the first time this year, you know, have it from one game to the next. They were able to carry things over, which they haven't been able to do in conference play. So they did what they had to do. They put themselves back in on solid footing. And now it's, can you do that now two weekends in a row, not just one game after another?
That's right. Let's move on to Columbia, South Carolina, where Mississippi State goes on the road and beats the Gamecocks 2 out of 3 times. Two shutout wins for the Bulldogs, 6-0 and 4-0 to start. South Carolina avoided the sweep, staved off that 0-4 record on the weekend with a 3-1 win. This was, by the way, a weekend where earlier in the week, South Carolina had to go to many, many extra innings to knock off Winthrop. So Elena Vauder, we had her on the show last week. She pitched great in game 3. Game 1 got sideways fairly quickly. I'll be honest, I picked Mississippi State 2-1. I don't think it was my lock, but this series kind of went down the way I thought it would. I think Mississippi State's offense is really, really good and really well-rounded, and I trusted Mississippi State's pitching more than I trusted South Carolina's offense. And this kind of played out like I figured it might.
It went a little bit differently than I thought it would. I thought South Carolina had kind of turned the corner. Apparently not. It's a, you know, I think we can kind of stop thinking about South Carolina as a top echelon type team in this league.
Wow.
Nothing against I think Mississippi State maybe has taken their spot. And because they're just performing at a more consistent, well-round pace than South Carolina has all year.
That's fair. Look, all 13 teams cannot be in the top 7 of the conference.
It's mathematically impossible.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, the team batting average to me is the biggest red flag. 242. That's not going to get it done.
Yeah, if your batting average is a little bit lower, the pitching has to be just absolutely lights out. We'd seen, it seemed as though the pitching staff had taken that step. Vauder especially had, you know, settled back in, but then, you know, gets rocked a little bit game 1, pitched really well in game 3, like you said. But you're just going to have to be a little bit sharper from the get go, unless the batting average really takes a tick up.
So we have a question. Can Sage Marjetko win SEC Freshman of the Year? I want to remind everybody, people get all up in arms sometimes. And Callen, I'm not 100. It could be Kalen. I'm sorry. If you could let me know in the comments, which is correct.
Mr. Dean. Yes.
Mr. Dean. It's important to note that SEC awards are decided based on conference only stats. So Sage Marjetko's overall stats this year are pretty good, but those unfortunately do not get factored in to what will decide the SEC awards. Could she win SEC Freshman of the Year? Potentially. Conference ERA is at, let me find it. I'm looking for it. Where is it? Here we go. 241, but a 1-3 record. She's only thrown 29 innings. And the problem is you've got Keegan Rothrock.
Right. It's going to be hard to beat either Rothrock or Brown for that.
Yeah. It's going to be really, really difficult to catch up to Rothrock. And if you do, then, you know, Ava Brown is not only pitching, but producing at the plate. So that's tough.
Yep.
Yep. Nolan says the same thing. I think Ava Brown has been pretty solid in conference. Could be in the combo. Agreed.
There you
go. One more team to talk about. Oh, I have had it right. It's Callen Dean. I knew it. See, trust your instincts, Gary.
Well,
that's what we do. Oh, man. All right. Last team to talk about, the Auburn Tigers, stepped out of conference. It was a a trappy weekend, I would say. You know, we talked about that on one of our many platforms, and they lost the closing game to Georgia Tech, just a kooky, dumb softball game that the Yellow Jackets won 10-9. There were a couple other kooky, dumb games on the Plains this weekend. Auburn, I mean, they are who we thought they were. That continues to be my takeaway. Every weekend, I am unsurprised by the result that I see.
Auburn has gotten to the point now where if Matty Pinta is not pitching, we complain or whatever, we analyze the fact that Matty Pinta has to pitch so often. But if she doesn't pitch, they can lose to pretty much anybody.
Yeah.
So I understand why she's out there pitching as much as she is. But yeah, I mean, that's the crazy game against Georgia Tech. That was the non-Pinta game. And then even the game that Matty Pinta did pitch, Georgia Tech had a 3-0 lead in the sixth, and Auburn came through to come back and beat the Yellow Jackets. And we've seen the Yellow Jackets in person. They're not a bad squad at all. When we noticed that they were in this tournament, I was like, oh, that's a problem for Auburn. Yeah, you have to watch out for Georgia Tech. They have a really good offense. You know, Auburn kind of is what they are.
Are you ready to look ahead, partner?
All right.
It's time to figure out what's due up.
New information.
Here's what's on the slate. First off, a question from Andrew Petty in the chat. Do we get a Tom's Hungry this week detailing the appetizers Tom ordered in for WrestleMania? On this show, but the Out of the Box podcast, perhaps.
Yeah, we can discuss it.
It's not like we're hosting award shows and doing 8 different segments this week. All right, what's on deck? Midweek Mayhem Tuesday, Clemson at South Carolina. South Carolina won in a very, very, very long softball game at Clemson a few weeks ago. I got to be honest, as much as we talked about the struggles of South Carolina, this game is infinitely more important for Clemson. Mm-hmm. So if South Carolina wins this, I'm almost writing Clemson off as a potential host of regionals. But
they're not even going to
DC pod.
They're not even going to make the packet. They're out of the packet if they lose to South Carolina, is what you're saying.
They're on the cut line right now. I will see what they do against Duke this weekend. But any thoughts about Wednesday? South Florida at Florida, South Alabama and Olivia Lackey at Mississippi State, and Kentucky at Louisville.
If South Alabama, which I assume they would, but if South Alabama does pitch Lackey, really interested to see what Mississippi State does with her.
Yeah, she has 3 SEC wins this year. So she had 3 in her career entering this year. Not bad.
There are a lot of SEC pitchers that don't have 3 wins.
True. Conference play continues. I'm calling this trap weekend. Why? Because most of the teams in the top 5 for the standings are going on the road. Florida is going to Missouri. Georgia is going to Kentucky. Tennessee is going to Mississippi State. And Texas A&M is going to Alabama. And also Arkansas at South Carolina. Arkansas not quite top 5, but I think they're 6th, if I read that correctly earlier. Yeah, 6th. So 5 of the top 6 are on the road this weekend. And then also you've got Auburn at LSU. Matty Pinto will probably win game 3. Tom, we have to pick a lock. I see a lot of potential pitfalls here for some of the contenders in the conference.
There are, you know, Tennessee at Mississippi State is going to be very, very interesting. And I think it's one of those situations where there's going to be 11 other teams in the conference that are going to be rooting for Mississippi State to, you know, kind of bring Tennessee back down to the pack a little bit. And it is a trappy weekend where the Bulldogs might be able to do that. Arkansas at South Carolina is very interesting as well. Georgia, they're a little based on what they are, a little bit of a rough patch going to Lexington, where I don't know if you know this, Gray, weird things happen in Lexington. Who knows what could happen there? Yeah, it's a very interesting weekend in the league for sure.
Do you have a lock?
I am going to go, considering what since they were able to go to Tennessee and the formula still held, I'm going to go with Auburn 2-1, or excuse me, with LSU 2-1 Auburn.
How many sweet How many locks have you made that have involved the Auburn Tigers this year?
I think all but one.
Okay, well.
I just took it away from you, so you couldn't do it.
That's what I get for letting you go first.
I know. Gentlemanly.
I'll go Georgia 2-1 at Kentucky. I think Schoonover is able to get a game.
Yeah.
Ooh. Callan says, lock in Arkansas sweep. Don't think South Carolina is hitting anyone, even Kamenzind and McGaffin. Interesting.
But he just said earlier in the podcast that they're the anti-Auburn 2-1.
Oh, no.
Oh, look out. You got to be consistent.
Oh, man. I'd forgotten about that. So good job, Tom. Well done.
He might be right, though. We'll see.
Florida at Missouri. Do you have any lean? Again, we'll pick it on the Out of the Box podcast, but is there anything that tickles your fancy with that series?
I feel pretty confident Florida's going to win that series. But Missouri, similar to Kentucky, weird things happen there. If the Missouri bats can get a little bit more consistent and get a little bit hot, it could be a trouble. But if I, you know, when we pick it later on, spoiler alert, I'll probably pick Florida to win 2-1.
Good to know. I'm not going to tease any of my picks because I have to go first this week. That's a spoiler.
Oh.
Yeah. Not a any final it's any final thoughts?
it's weird. We talked about it, I think, in our group chat. I don't remember about it. But that it's funny that we do a podcast where our job is to predict what's happening in this conference, and it is the toughest year of in recent memory to predict what's going to happen in this conference. It is amazing how things can change from day in, day out, game in, game out in this league right now.
Yeah, it makes it fun, but it makes the picking part hard.
It makes it very difficult.
Yeah. Enjoy the softball and trap weekend and all the crazy things that will go down, and I'm sure that there will be plenty of drama and excitement. And also, if I may add one programming note.
Oh, yeah.
We will. I forgot to do this.
Oh, no.
Schedule announcement. Yeah, no show next week.
None at all.
We're going to be working.
Yeah,
Alabama and Texas A&M will be playing Monday Night Softball. The Out of the Box podcast, because we don't have to drive to Tallahassee the next day, will be coming out at some point next week, but it just means more softball. We're going to take the week off. We'll be back in 2 weeks for a regular show. And also, Tom, if I may, check out Bama SB on SEC Network after Alabama Texas A&M next Monday. A lot of people put in a lot of work for that documentary. Patrick Murphy said on our TV interview that they've been working on it since fall of 22, and it's ready, and it will be airing a week from tonight, right on the dot, with an extra hour added in there.
Yeah, even if you're not an Alabama fan, it's a really good documentary just for the sport of softball, and telling what it was a great story in what happened in 2012 as the SEC got their first national championship.
Jennifer C.
Who?
Ray with the videos.
Yes, indeed.
Fang Nye. I love these intro videos. Thank you, Fang. That's really good. Nice. And
one person does. Oh,
Andrew. Not again. This is the last time we're going to have a schedule announcement, so I can delete that from the
queue. No, don't do it.
Maybe I'll just you play never it again. Know. I don't know. I can't believe I didn't have that on the rundown. It's time to wrap up the show. Tom, thank you, as always.
Thank you very much. It was a fun week, and looking forward to what is going to be a very interesting weekend in the world of SEC softball.
Thank you to our guest, Morgan Leinstock. Again, if you're just now here, where have you been? Go check out the audio version or the video version once it's on of our interview with Morgan Leinstock from Arkansas, and hear her story. You know, she has been through so much as someone who was born deaf and is now an ace essentially on an SEC team. It's really incredible what she's done on her journey. So I highly recommend you go and listen to that and take some inspiration from it, like I feel like we did, Tom.
Yeah, for sure. Check that out. And it's interesting. Every week we seem to get a different aspect and different storylines with all the really great players and coaches that we've talked to already on this podcast.
Absolutely. And make sure that you like and subscribe on the Softball America YouTube page and subscribe to the audio platform on Apple Podcasts and check out all the other great shows. Nicole with 10 Teams, 2 Rings, and maybe a little spinoff that Nicole and I are working on. Sydney's Spin, The Final Swing, Walton's World, all the shows. Check them out.
I assume they were talking about a certain Red River Rivalry series this past weekend.
I don't know who the guest is, but it's someone from Texas.
There you go.
Yeah, we'll be recording that tomorrow. So anyway, that's it for It Just Means More Softball. For my partner, Tom Canterbury, I'm Gray Robertson. Thank y'all so much for tuning in. Remember, I could play the video again, but I won't. No show next week. We'll be back in 2 weeks. Until then, enjoy the softball. We'll see y'all next time.